Hi there, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. And I must make an announcement. Joan Wilshire was going to be in with us today, but she is off and not feeling very well, so we want to send her the very best at the top of the show. And so I'm going to try to keep things going here for the next half hour and let you know that we're in our 25th year of this production. And Lisa Largis and Susan Kusz are here from the State Services for the Blind. And so I'm going to say hi to them, and then they're going to run the show after this. Hi, guys. Welcome to the show.
Hi.
Congratulations on 25 years.
Thank you.
That's awesome.
It takes a village. A lot of people back here that make this happen. So thanks for being here. State Services for the Blind has quite a history and been around for a long time. Can you tell us a little bit about that? Give us a little background.
Yeah, we're going to be celebrating our 100th anniversary here in the next year. So we are very proud of that. Lisa, you've been at State Services a little bit longer than I have. What can you say besides the 100th anniversary?
You started as a customer, I understand.
I did, absolutely. And in fact, I have used the services of State Services for the Blind since I was a kid, when SSB, as we call it, brailled the textbooks that I used. Later, when I went off to college, I met with one of our vocational rehabilitation counselors who helped me navigate kind of the transition from high school to life after high school. And
Like a voc rehab?
Right, exactly. We are the voc rehab program for Minnesotans who are blind, visually impaired, or deafblind. And so we're the sister agency with Vocational Rehabilitation Services, who work with Minnesotans with all other disabilities, which Susan's going to talk about in just a minute, too. And then I went off and did all kinds of things and had a very colored career, and landed back in Minnesota, and so called up State Services for the Blind saying, hey, I'm looking for work, and can you help me out? And they were awesome. I, again, hooked up with a counselor, applied for a ton of jobs. And then it so happens that my sister is a Braille proofreader. She proofreads all the math and science textbooks in the state of Minnesota and works at State Services for the Blind. And she's like, hey, they have an opportunity for an outreach coordinator. So they just need somebody who likes to talk a lot and go talk to people. So I applied for that job, and here I am. And what I love about my work is it gives me a chance to kind of pay it forward. I have benefited so much from all that we do, and so to have a chance to go out and tell other folks, especially folks who may not know about what we do, that we have services available that can, you know, in many instances, change somebody's life. Or help give people just enough of a step up that it makes that crucial difference for them. So just real quick before I turn it back over to Susan, we do three things basically. Like I said, we have services for Minnesotans who are blind or visually impaired or deafblind who are looking for work, who either want to take the next step in their career, who may be employed and all of a sudden are experiencing vision loss and want to figure out, what can I do to keep my job and how can I learn the skills I need to have in order to be successful as a person living as a person who is blind or visually impaired or deafblind, right? So we do that. We have a communication center. And the awesome thing about our communication center is that we serve any Minnesotan who has a disability that makes reading print difficult. So obviously that could be reading print is difficult because you can't see it. But it could be maybe you have a processing disorder, or maybe you have a hard time holding a physical book. So if reading in audio or e-text or Braille is easier for you, if that's the way that you can access print, we are here for you. That's what we do.
So at any age, I mean, you don't...
Any age, that is absolutely right. Yep, yep. Mm-hmm.
And you're going to be 100 years old?
Right. I am not going to be 100.
Not you, but the operation is.
But our agency is going to be 100 years old in 2023. Yep.
Well, and also just recently too, Lisa, talk a little bit about how you brought on some people that are now translating books from other languages.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you had a big part to do with that, right?
I have had a small part to do with that, but you know, we have worked primarily in English, because our staff and our volunteers generally work in English, but we want to serve all Minnesotans who need access to print, including significant folks in our state, including the Hmong population, Somalis, Karen, both the Dakota and the Ojibwe. And so we have been trying to figure this out. Like, what can we do? So what we figured out we could do is connect with local authors. Recently, we met with Kalia Yang, who's just a phenomenal writer. And she, one of her books was translated into Hmong. She came into our studios and read that book for us. Glenn Westerman, who's the poet laureate of Minnesota, came and read a book of her poetry, which is partially in the Dakota language. We've now recorded books in Karen, in Ojibwe, in Hmong, and Somali. So we are like making a start.
May I ask a question?
Yeah.
The St. Paul schools, even the charter schools, have the different populations in them.
Mm-hmm.
Are you doing anything in collaboration with the St. Paul schools? Because that can start at a much younger age, you know, the books on tape and the...
Right, yeah. We do Braille some textbooks for students in other languages. I know that we're working on several Spanish language textbooks right now. And we're working with the St. Paul Public Library, but we haven't worked directly with the St. Paul Public Schools, and that's really a fabulous lead too. Yep. And I'm just going to finish off by saying that... Don't worry about it. That's awesome. The third thing that we do is we serve seniors. So lots of Minnesotans, are living into their 80s and 90s, and all of a sudden are developing macular degeneration or glaucoma or... Right. Diabetic retinopathy or even cataracts, right? And all of a sudden life changes. And we have counselors who we send out to meet with folks in their homes. And then we provide aids and devices just to make, like, we're just talking with one customer the other day who has a weekly poker game. We provided them with a large
they know how to have fun
card. We are here to keep people independent and active and a part of their community. That's our job. So seniors who are losing their vision, even if you're in the early stages of vision loss, our folks will meet with you to figure out, okay, what do you need to stay in your home or to stay where you are, and just continue doing the things you love to do. And we have trainers who can help folks learn technology, help folks learn how to cook and do other skills of daily living. All of that we do, and it's all available to any Minnesotan who has a vision loss. So just get a hold of us, and we will tell you more.
Great, great. Now, the insurance companies, do they do anything as far as getting the vision impaired around to, like, doctor's appointments, eye doctor's appointments, and so on and so forth? Is it because some of the disabilities you can put towards some of the insurances to cover your transportation?
Yeah, wow, that's an answer that I do not know. We really work out of a rehabilitation model of disability. where, you know, your disability is tied into your identity, who you are, right, rather than kind of a medical model.
Right.
Yeah. So, and we don't provide, we don't have like any direct transportation services for folks either. But right. Yeah.
Great. Great. So you're kind of quiet over here.
Well, I was allowing Lisa to talk about state services for the blind, and you know, the other sister agency that probably other people are familiar with is the vocational rehab, and that's where I really tapped into that years ago. Unfortunately, I was assaulted in a car accident in the late 90s, and so I went to DEED, vocational rehab, and I was able to receive services to help, like, pursue education, search for a job. These are the types of things that, very similar to, you know, the things that happen at SSB, because we're sister agencies. We do the same sorts of things.
But you can still drive now.
Yeah, actually, I became self-sufficient. I was able to get off of Social Security disability, and I got hired by the state in 2005. I went on the Ticket to Work program.
Jim Ramstead authored, co-authored that a long time ago.
Yeah, that's right.
It's still around, and Jeff Bangsberg and I, a long time ago, we talked to Jim a lot about disability employment, and that's what Jim came up with, and it's still running today.
Well, it was a great idea because it's a safety net, and for someone who is trying to be self-sufficient, there are so many things, you know, previously being like on welfare, mom of two, and being in, you know, county support, it was very difficult to be self-sufficient. And so having the Ticket to Work program was very helpful because I was like, okay, so if something goes wrong, I at least have something to fall back on. I don't have to go through the whole process of reapplying.
And that's the one thing that really went right back then.
Yeah, yeah. So, and now, you know, like with more than 500,000 Minnesotans reporting that they have one or more disability, and the unemployment rate of this group has more than doubled, DEED is really trying to concentrate not so much even on the diversity, equity, and inclusion, but we're also really concentrating and committed to concentrating on accessibility and opportunity. So for me, I've been very fortunate twice in my lifetime to go to DEED and get services to help keep me employed. So there was another instance when, after I became a state employee, that I got diagnosed with a processing disorder. And I went back to DEED and said, hey, my insurance isn't gonna cover the treatment for this. Can you help me? Because otherwise, I'm gonna be without a job. And they said, okay, yes, we'll, you know, help foot the bill for it.
We'll accommodate is what they said.
Yeah, well, yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah, they probably didn't say foot the bill. You're right. And so, you know, I was very fortunate. And so,
but I understand what you said. I got that. Mm-hmm.
So for me, I'm very proud to be working for the agency that has helped me level up and become, you know, I'm a person with hidden disabilities, but a person that, you know, is very proud and honored to work for the agency that helped me get to where I am today, being right, self-sufficient.
Well, and the thing that I hope they realize is that you understand the organization full circle, because you've been helped by it, you work for it. You're learning each and every day, so you're doing the best you can with the tools you were given, and so they've got a great employee there, and I hope they recognize that someday.
I would say DEED does. I actually, you know, I'd say both Lisa and I are success stories when it comes
you
to
are, you are
looking at
you are, And October is Employment Awareness Month, and I don't remember what we have scheduled for October, but I hope you know that I'm big on disability employment.
That's awesome.
I've always had some, but I want everybody that can to have a piece of some, and disability employment, that is. And so,
well, it's definitely part of the equation of equity. Mm-hmm. I think that for businesses, if they, there's so many businesses right now, Mark, behind COVID, that don't have enough employees. And I think if businesses, and that's part of what DEET is in the business of trying to do, is help businesses look at the fact that you can take people that have disabilities and figure this out. How can we get people that have disabilities employed and working out there in the workforce? They are definitely part of the solution. They're not part of the problem. I think for so many years, people have looked at people with disabilities as being a burden or a problem.
Yeah, it's because you bring on a disabled person per your employment within your organization, and it's a whole different avenue. It takes like an opportunity partners, a life works. Maybe it takes a operation like that whereby they bring their employees in and they have a job coach, and they're actually on site. Now, you're always going to have, if you're a disabled person in a company, and they bring you on, you're always going to have that fear. Some employees are really going to like you. Some employees need to get used to it. Some employees aren't going to like you for whatever reason. But that's just one of those things. We need to lift those barriers. We need to educate. Yeah. Yeah. We need to get people into it.
And that's the key right there, is the education. The stigma really needs to go away. What I really learned in the first couple of weeks that I was at SSB was that, some of my coworkers, like Lisa, they can do such amazing things that like I never would have imagined. People that have there's the stigma. You think, oh, they have a disability, so they can't do this or they can't do that. And it's just simply not true.
I found that on Amtrak. I couldn't go to the dining car. I couldn't go to the bar. I don't drink, but I couldn't go to the bar. So what I could do is sit in my seat and go to the restroom, and then they'd bring the food to me. Well, part of the idea of being on vacation is socializing.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And you can't, you can socialize from your seat, but you got a bigger opportunity if you go to the restaurant or the bar, is to interact with people. And we've always got to, we got to do a better job of lifting those barriers. This is 2022, and you've got all these computers, and we can send men to the moon, and we can start to have autonomous vehicles.
But where's
which is a
the
good
accessibility?
Thing. But where's the accessibility? That's one for
right.
all and all for one.
That's right.
And that's what we need to do. There was a gentleman that spoke at 3M when I was in the State Council for Disabilities, and he had an organization. I'd like to say it was either Walmart or Walgreens, one of those two. And his son had ADHD, so he couldn't work, but his dad hired him to be his driver. So he flew quite a bit, and they lived in Chicago, I want to say. So the son would have to take him to the airport and have to be there when he lands, no matter if it was in the morning or at night. But what he did is he took his employees and matched them and put an able-bodied employee and a disabled employee together, paid them the same, give them all the benefits. Now, that disabled person had a different way of getting the job done, but they were all given the same chance. And I remember the story, and I'm sorry I don't remember what company it is. It's quite a few years ago now since I've been on the State Council on Disabilities, but it was a great story. And that's what I was hoping employment would be one day, that we all work together.
And I think that's something, too, that DEET is working on as well, is getting rid of the sub-minimum wage for people with disabilities, because that's been a huge problem. And for those people that don't understand what that is that people think, employers think that they can pay someone, you know, like way below minimum wage, unliving amount of money to do the same amount of work.
And then take the tax break they get because they're
And so we're really trying to get away from that. I know even at State Services for the Blind, so some of the things that didn't get touched on that we do also have at State Services for the Blind is we have a radio station, we have a business enterprise program where we have blind operators that go and fill the vending machines at the state rest stops and in state and federal buildings. And so those are owned companies by people that are blind.
There's a guy down at the state capitol that has vending machines too.
He is part of the business enterprise program through SSB. That's correct.
When I'm down there testifying, I have quite a bit of stuff from him, so I support
That's
him.
That's awesome. That's really great.
I support him pretty well.
Yeah,
we got about 3 or 4 minutes left. Is there anything we haven't really covered yet, or anything you want to say to the board segment?
I just wanted to jump in and say that Susan's been referring to DEED, which is the Department of Employment and Economic Development, and both State Services for the Blind and Vocational Rehabilitation Services are a part of that, but the Department of Employment and Economic Development is here for all Minnesotans, job seekers and employers alike. Yes. We're here to make a better economy for all of Minnesota.
Yeah,
and really, what DEED is saying is that for employers, it's not a feel-good thing anymore. It's a competitive edge to hire people with disabilities. If you want somebody who's creative, who knows how to think outside the box, if you want somebody who's dedicated, who wants a chance, who's ready to work hard, people with disabilities are the untapped employment pool that employers need to reach out to, and it makes a difference. Like I said, it's your competitive edge in this economy where finding good employees who will stick around is not as easy as it used to be. So for sure, like if you are hiring folks, you know, consider someone with a disability. And here's the thing to do. When you sit down with that person for an interview, just say to them, tell me how you're going to do this job. And they will tell you. They're not going to apply for a job that they can't do. So maybe you don't know how somebody's going to see the computer screen. Well, they'll explain how all of that works, you know?
We hope that you hire a disabled person for the talent that they have.
Yep, that's right.
Or the education ability that they have.
That's exactly right.
A final thought before we go, we're going to wrap this thing up.
No, I just want to say thank you, Lisa, for clarifying all of that. I think that's a point really well taken.
Well, Lisa Larges and Susan Kusz, I want to thank you very much for being on the show, and I want to thank everybody at home for watching, and the folks at SPNN for helping us produce this thing, and we hope you'll keep watching, and we'll have these folks back, I'm sure, at some point, because Disability Employment Month is coming right up, and we want to let you know what an important part of a social aspect of a disability person's life of employment is. So I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints. We'll see you soon. Bye for now.